Quadrature hybrid coupler. Quadrature hybrid coupler is another important type of directional coupler. And quadrature hybrid coupler is basically a 3 dB directional coupler. This means that it divides the power between the two boards with equal amplitudes, but with phase shift 90 degrees. And effectively, this phase shift is a key point of its name, quadrature. So we have quadrature phase shift. So 90 phase shift degrees or 90 phase shift difference in the output of the through and coupled arms. This type of hybrid is often made in microstrip lines or strip lines. Usually it doesn't make from waveguides. It is also known as branch line coupler or branch line hybrid. Effectively, the basic operation of the branch line coupler can be obtained in this figure. If the power is incident at port 1, then half of this power will go to the port 2 as a through, and the other half will go to port 3, while port 4 is isolated. If the incident power is going from port 4, so half power is going to port 3 and the other half will go to port 2, while port 1 is isolated. If the power is incident from port 2, so half the power is going through port 1 and the other half will go through port 4, and port 3 in this case will be isolated. Finally, if the incident power is going from port 3, half of the power will go to port 4, and the other half will go to port 1, and port 2 would be isolated. In all cases, the through signal will have phase shift minus 90 degrees, and the coupled signal will have phase shift minus 180 degrees. So, there is a phase shift between the two outputs with minus 90 degrees. This means that if the signal of the input has a phase equal 0, the output at port 2 would have a phase minus 90 degrees, and the signal at port 3 has a phase minus 180 degrees. So there is a phase shift between port 2 and port 3, the two outputs, of 90 degrees. This branch line hybrid coupler is composed of four arms as seen here. The two horizontal arms which are connecting the input signal to the through has a characteristic impedance of Z0 over square root 2. While the parallel arms has a characteristic impedance Z0. And all the arms have a length of lambda over 4 at the center frequency. If we collect these bits together, we can see that the scattering matrix of the hybrid coupler or the branch line coupler would be, if I'm exciting from port 1, so we are talking about the first column, the power will be divided between port 2 and port 3, and port 4 is isolated, and the reflection at port 1 is also 0. Okay? The magnitude of the power at port 2 and port 3 is 1 over square root 2. This is the magnitude of the signal, sorry. The magnitude of the power is the square of this value. So it is 1 over 2, 1 over 2. This is the magnitude of the electric field. 1 over square root 2 is the magnitude of the electric field or the magnitude of the voltage. The magnitude of the power, it would be 1 over 2. Alright? The phase of the output at port 2, it would be minus J. Means that it has phase shift minus 90 degrees with respect to the input port. The phase at port 3 would be minus 1. So it has a phase shift 180 degrees from port 1. Or in other words, there is a phase shift between port 2 and port 3 minus 90 degrees. If the excitation from port 2, then the bar will be divided between port 1 and port 4. Here, this column corresponds to the excitation from port 2. Port 1 will have a phase shift minus 90 degrees. And port 4 will have a phase shift minus 180 degrees. And both have the same amplitude. In a similar way, if the excitation from port 3, the through will be to port 4 with a phase shift 90 degrees, minus 90 degrees. And the coupled signal will be to port 1 with a phase shift minus 180 degrees because of this minus, alright? Finally, if the excitation from port 4 would be the fourth column, would be divided between port 3 and port 2. Port 3 would be the through, port 3 would be the through with a phase shift minus 90 degrees, and port 2 would be the coupled signal with a phase shift minus 180 degrees. This is the scattering matrix of ideal hybrid coupler or branch line coupler. The question now is how we obtain this scattering matrix and how we obtain this design. To do this, we are going to introduce a simplified or normalized circuit for the branch line coupler. So, the normalized circuit is normalized with respect to Z0. So, it is assumed that the input line has a characteristic impedance 1, while this arm will have a characteristic impedance of 1 over square root 2, and this arm will have a characteristic impedance 1, and the length of all these four arms, each arm would be lambda over 4. And these four arms, which correspond to the branch line coupler, would be connected to transmission lines with a characteristic impedance 1, or normalized characteristic impedance 1. We are going to discuss the analysis if we have the excitation from port 1, and we have port 2, port 3, and port 4 are connected to matched load with impedance or normalized impedance 1. So we have an amplitude A1 from port 1, and we have reflected signal B1 from port 1, we have transmitted signal from port 2 B2, we have transmitted signal B3 from port 3, and we have transmitted signal B4 from port 4. By calculating B1, B2, B3, B4 with respect to the value of A1, we can obtain S11, S21, S31, and S41. Okay? So, this is a simplified circuit or the normalized simplified circuit that we are going to study. To study this simplified circuit, we are going to divide this circuit into two modes, even and odd modes. In even mode, we are going to take half the excitation from port 1 and the other half from port 4, and both of them have the same magnitude and the same phase. And we have two matched loads at port 2 and port 3. This is even mode formulation of the branch line coupler. On the other hand, the odd mode, we have half of the signal is excited from port 1 and half of the signal is excited from port 4 with a phase shift 180 degrees. So this is 1 over 2 and this is minus 1 over 2. And once again, the two outputs, ports 2 and 3, are matched to or are connected to matched loads. If we combine the even and the odd circuits, we can note that the total signal at port 1 it would be 1, and the total signal at port 4 it would be 0. So this would correspond to the conventional branch line coupler. So we are going to solve the even mode circuit separately and to solve the odd mode circuit separately. And from the solution of the even and odd modes, we can obtain the total solution of the circuit. So the total reflection coefficient B1, it would be the reflection coefficient of the even mode plus the reflection coefficient of the odd mode. And because this with an amplitude half, so half the reflection coefficient of the even mode plus half the reflection coefficient of the odd mode. For the transmitted signal, the transmitted signal here at port 2, because here it is positive and here it is positive, so the total transmitted signal for the branch line coupler B2 would be half the transmitted signal for the even mode plus half the transmitted signal for the odd mode. On the other hand, the transmitted signal at port 3. At port 3, we have here the input is going to be positive here and positive here, but the input is going to be positive from here and negative from here. So in this case, the transmission at port 3, it would be the transmission coefficient from the even mode multiplied by half minus half the transmission coefficient of the odd mode, because in this case the transmitted signal at port 3 would be in negative sign with respect to the original mode. In a similar way, if we are talking about the reflection coefficient at or the signal at port 4, the signal at port 4 it would be from the even mode would be the reflection coefficient due to the excitation of 1/2, but it would be minus the reflection coefficient due to the excitation of the odd mode. So it would be half gamma even minus half gamma odd. So if we have the reflection and the transmission coefficients of the even and odd modes, we can obtain the value of the signals at the four ports due to the incident signal at the port 1 for the conventional branch line coupler. Now by looking at the even mode circuit, we can note that the potential at this terminal is the same as the potential at this terminal. Also, the potential at this terminal is the same as the potential at this terminal. And so, everything is symmetric. So, there is no current will flow from this point to this point. There is no current will flow from this point to this point. It means that if we don't have any current flowing through these lines, this means that we can replace or we can make an image for this circuit by an open circuit, because there is no current is going at this part. This means that the upper part of the even mode circuit and the lower part of the even mode circuit can be represented by two completely different circuits with open circuit between of them, because there is no current passing through them. And if we look at these two circuits, they are exactly the same. So it would be quite sufficient to solve one circuit to obtain the reflection coefficient for the even mode and the transmission coefficient for the even mode in this case. On the other hand, for the odd mode, we can note that because this positive half and this negative half, so from this we can obtain that the potential at the midpoint between them must be zero, And the potential of zero is actually the potential of the ground. So, in this case, the potential at the midpoint here is zero. The potential at the midpoint here is zero. So, we can replace this circuit by equivalent two circuits with the ground plane connected at the midpoint as shown here. From this, we can obtain the equivalent of circuit for the upper arm of the odd circuit and the equivalent circuit for the lower part of the odd circuit. And should be noted here, the only difference is that the excitation here is positive half and the excitation here is negative half. And this actually is the reason when we are talking about the transmission at vortex 3 here, it is minus the transmission of the odd because it is going from minus half, it is not going from half. And the reflection at vortex 4 is minus gamma naught or gamma odd because it is coming from a source with minus half, not positive half. Okay? So, now we have an even circuit and an odd circuit, and from this even circuit and odd circuit is required to determine the reflection coefficient, gamma even, transmission even, and gamma odd and transmission odd. And from gamma even, transmission even, gamma odd, transmission odd, we can obtain the signals of the complete circuit at the four ports B1, B2, B3, and B4 in terms of the incident signal. And because we are normalizing everything to unity, so the value of B here it would be S11, the value of B2 it would be S21, the value of B3 it would be S31, and the value of B4 it would be S41. In this way, we can obtain the four elements of the scattering matrix, assuming that the feeding is coming from port 1. We start with even mode analysis. So, we are going to take the upper half of the equivalent even mode circuit. It can be noted that it is composed of an open stop. And as we mentioned, the length here is lambda over 4, so this stub is lambda by 8. And we have a transmission line section with a characteristic impedance 1 over square root 2 and length lambda over 4. And another parallel stub, lambda over 8 with characteristic impedance 1. As we mentioned, we can assume that this cascaded circuit, this circuit 1, stop, cascade with a transmission line, cascaded with another stop. So, we can say that the total ABCD parameter of these three cascaded networks, it can be obtained as the ABCD of the first circuit, which is the open circuit stop, multiplied by the ABCD of the transmission line section of characteristic impedance 1 over square root 2 of length lambda over 4, multiplied by the ABCD of another stop of length lambda over 8. The values of the ABCD of the stub and the transmission lines are already discussed in chapter 4 in network analysis. So, the shunt stub will have the following ABCD matrix. The transmission line will have this ABCD matrix and the shunt stub will have this ABCD matrix. By multiplying these three matrices together, we can obtain the total ABCD of these three sections together. So, this is the ABCD of Stop, transmission line, stop. And this stop is open circuit. Okay. From this ABCD, we can obtain the corresponding scattering matrix. So, from this, we can obtain the scattering matrix. It will be S11 and S21. And S22 equals S11 because the circuit is symmetric. And S12 equals S21 because it is reciprocal. So, from the symmetry and reciprocity, we can determine S11 as the reflection coefficient. And in this case, it would be called gamma even because we are talking about the even mode circuit. And S21, it would be the transmission coefficient of the even. So, by using the obtained ABCD matrix for this configuration, we can obtain S11 and S21 in terms of the ABCD. S11, it was A plus B minus C minus D over A plus B plus C plus D, assuming that the characteristic impedance is normalized to unity. A here is minus 1 over square root 2. Everything is over square root 2. Minus 1. B is J. C is J. D is minus 1. So we have this form over this form. We can note that the reflection coefficient of the even mode is 0. On the other hand, the transmission coefficient S21 is 2 over AB, A plus B plus C plus D. Also, assuming that this node is unity. And from this, we can obtain that the transmission coefficient for the even mode is minus 1 over square root 2 multiplied by 1 plus G. Now we have obtained the reflection coefficient and transmission coefficient for the even mode circuit. In similar steps, we can obtain the ABCD for the odd mode circuit. In this case, the only one difference is that instead of using open circuit stub, it would be short circuit stub. So we are going to obtain the ABCD of short circuit stub with length lambda over 8 multiplied by ABCD of transmission line with characteristic impedance 1 over square root 2 and length lambda over 4 multiplied by the ABCD of another stub similar to the first stub. By following these steps, we can obtain the ABCD for the odd function is 1 over square root 2, 1 j j 1. It should be noted here the difference is that this was minus 1, here it is positive 1. Okay, and once again, by using these values of ABCD in this formulas, we can obtain gamma odd and t odd. So by using this ABCD, we can obtain gamma odd equals 0, and t odd in this case, it would be 1 over square root 2 multiplied by 1 minus g. Alright, it should be noted here the difference between t even and t odd. T even is minus 1 over square root 2, 1 plus g. Here it is plus 1 over square root 2, 1 minus g. Now we have gamma even, t even, gamma odd, t odd. We are going to apply this to calculate the value of b1, b2, b3, and b4. From this, we can obtain the total value of b1 is half gamma even plus half gamma odd. Gamma even is 0, gamma odd is 0, so b1 is 0. b2 is 1 over 2 te, t even, plus 1 over 2 t odd, so half the transmission coefficient of the even mode plus half the transmission coefficient of the odd mode. By adding these two together, we can obtain b2 is minus g over square root 2, which is half the power, because as a magnitude of the power, it is 1 over square root 2 squared, so it is 1 over 2, half power, with a phase shift minus 90 degree because of this minus j. And this actually corresponds to S21. So the phase shift from port 1 to 2 is minus 90 degrees. B3 is half TE minus half TO. So half TE minus half TO. We can calculate it. We can find it. It is half. It is minus 1 over square root 2. So from the point of view of power, it is half power. From the point of view of the phase, it is minus 180 degrees phase shift from port 1 to port 3. Finally, B4 is half gamma E minus half gamma O. Gamma E and gamma O is 0, so B4 is 0, 0. So there is no power going to port 4, or port 4 is isolated. Actually, this is the first column of the scattering matrix of the branch line coupling. In a similar way, we can obtain the other columns. So we can prove the remaining part of the scattering matrix. The response of the branch line coupler is actually well defined at the center frequency of the design, because as I said, the arms are of length lambda over 4. So if we are changing the frequency, we are changing the length of these arms. So by changing the length of the arms with respect to the wavelength, the value of S14 will not be any more isolated. There will be some value of the power is going from port 1 to port 4. Also, the value of S11 will not be exactly matched. S12 and S13 at the center frequency are ideally minus 3 dB. But if we are deviating from the center frequency, they will deviate from minus 3 dB. Also, the phase shift is exactly minus 90 degrees. It doesn't appear here in this figure. But if we are deviating from the center frequency, the phase shift will not be exactly minus 90 degrees between S12 and S13. This is briefly the response of branch line coupler as a function of the frequency from 0.5 F0 to 1.5 F0. It is exact performance at the center frequency F0. Okay. Comments on the branch line coupler. In practice, due to the quarter wavelength requirement, the bandwidth of the branch line coupler or branch line hybrid coupler is limited to be around 10 to 20%. However, by using multi-section matching transformer instead of using just 1 λ/4, we can use multiple λ/4 and all of them like square, like the square branch line coupler. So with multi-section matching transformer and the multi-hole directional coupler, the bandwidth of the branch line coupler can be increased to a decade or more by using multiple sections of cascade. In addition, the basic design can be modified for unequal power division, but actually it is quite difficult, and or different characteristic of impedance of output ports. Another practical point to be aware of is the fact this continuity effect at the junction of the branch line coupler may require the shunt arm's length to be lengthened or changed from 10 to 20 degrees. For example, if we look at the original branch line coupler, we said that this is impedance of Z0 over square root 2. What will happen at this junction between Z0 and Z0 over square root 2? In the equivalent circuit, we simply said that we have a transmission line of characteristic impedance 1 connected to a transmission line of impedance 1 over square root 2. But this junction itself, it has an effect also to go from Z0, and we have two branches to Z0 and Z0 over square root 2. This junction has a significant effect on the performance of the branch line coupler. So in the design performance, we should take this junction into consideration. This is briefly what is called or what is mean by branch line coupler or hybrid coupler. Okay? All right.